We have seen how we can define various norms on the Euclidean spaces on RD. So in particular, we have looked at the P norms for various values of P. Now, from a mathematical point of view, people always wonder why we do that, because mathematicians typically say on Rn, all norms are equivalent. And that's true. And this is the theorem that we want to discuss today in our lecture. I want to say a caveat right at the beginning. What the equivalence says is that the norms can be easily transformed one into another. So you can find, if you want, there's a continuous transformation that brings you from one norm to the other norm. It is nice, it is Lipschitz bounded, and so on. For machine learning, it does, of course, the norms are not equivalent because they induce very different biases to the machine learning algorithms. So even though from this mathematical point of view, the norms are equivalent, they do not behave the same way when we actually engage them into algorithms. But anyways, I want to show you that theorem because also in machine learning, it's often the case, like if you're more about looking into theoretical properties, sometimes you want to know whether sequences converge and so on, and then it doesn't really matter in which norm we operate to prove these kinds of results. Here's now the statement. We now want to consider the following theorem, which says all norms on Rn are, and I write in parentheses, topologically equivalent. And what does it mean? What the statement is supposed to mean is if we have two norms indicated by letters A and B, if norm A and norm B both operate on Rn, are two different norms, are two norms on Rn, then there exist constants alpha and beta larger than zero, such that the following inequality holds. For all x in Rn, I first write it down, alpha times the norm of x, like the A norm of x, is smaller than the B norm of x, and this is smaller than beta times the A norm of x, so norm of x, index A. So let's digest this. We have two different norms, A indicated by an A and a B. It could be the infinity norm and the one norm if you want. And now it says that we can find constants. I mean, we first look for constants alpha and beta. And once we have these constants, we can say that for all x in our space, there is this inequality between the norms, which essentially says, well, if the B norm of x is, say, 5, then maybe the A norm might be a bit lower, and it might also be a bit higher with a certain constant alpha and beta, but essentially they can't behave completely different. And the reason here is, the important thing is that we first pick the constant and then have the for all x in our Rn statement, because otherwise it wouldn't really make so much sense. And this is a theorem that is really important, and I want to prove it. The proof, I mean, it looks a bit complicated because we don't make any statement about what these norms might be, but the proof is surprisingly simple. And the first trick is to observe that it is enough to prove that if I have a norm I know well, for example, the infinity norm, then it is enough to prove that the infinity norm is equivalent to any other norm in my space. And so I write, without loss of generality, so this is the abbreviation, without loss of generality, we prove that if the normal norm is any norm on RD, then it is equivalent to the infinity norm, where the infinity norm is the one that we have defined in our previous lecture. So the infinity norm of a vector just tells us what is the largest, gives us the order, like the magnitude of the largest component in the vector. And now we need to prove the two, like we are, there are two inequalities we need to prove. Maybe I make a little star here. So this is the important property that we need to prove, and now we need to prove that in both directions. So you need to prove that you can, given the norm, you can always upper bound it by a constant times the infinity norm and the other way around. So there are two steps. So we start with the first inequality. So what we want to prove is there exists a constant C1 larger than zero, such that for all x, if you look at this arbitrary norm, it is smaller than the constant C times the infinity norm. Okay? So this is the first thing that we need to prove. And then we need to prove it the other way around. But let's start with this one. So we haven't proved that yet. This is what we're trying to achieve. Okay, and now let's do it. This is surprisingly simple. So we now consider a vector in the standard basis. So we say let x being is the sum of xi, ei. So ei is now the unit vector, the ith unit vector, and xi is the real number that gives us the coordinate in this representation. So let this be the representation of x in the standard basis, of Rt, of course. And now we can start to do a bit of math. So we want to compute this norm here. And this is now observed, this is the new norm, the one that we don't know which one it is any norm. So what do we know? So this is now by definition the sum of xi, the norm of the sum of xi. This is our definition of the vector. Now, by the triangle inequality, we can take out the sum from this norm. We can write this is smaller or equal than the sum. I now drop all the index. I don't always write the boundaries of the sum. So the index is I. Norm of x I e I. This was by the triangle inequality, and by the homogeneity, I can also write this as the sum remains. I pull the x I out as an absolute value. Norm of e I. Okay, and now we know we don't know what the norm of e I is because this is just some norm in our space. We don't have any clue, but what we know is that this x I is definitely smaller than the infinity norm of x. Oh, sorry, infinity. Because by definition, the infinity norm is the one that looks at the largest component in our vector. And so this is smaller than the infinity norm, by definition of the norm. And so it's easy, now we can say, so this is smaller or equal than the sum of the infinity norm of x, which is now a real number, times ei. And I can write this, I can now pull the infinity norm to the front. This is just a constant, it's independent of I, so the sum always goes over I. So this is the same as taking the infinity norm to the front times the sum of the norm of EIs. And now I can define this sum here. This is something I don't know, it is any real number, but I simply define it as being the constant C1. And then I'm done. Because now if you read the equation from left to right, what do we have? We have here the norm of x, which is what we started with. And then we have lots of smaller or equal signs. And at the other side, we have it is smaller or equal than the constant C1, as we defined it, times the infinity norm. And observe the constant does not depend on x or so. So this is a unique constant that we can use for any point in the vector space. So this is the first quantity that we needed to prove, the first inequality. Now we need to prove it the other way around. So the second inequality, let me just see what my level of indentation is. Second inequality, it shouldn't be pink. Yeah. Second inequality. Now we want to prove it the other way around. What we want to have is there exists a constant C2 larger than zero, such that for all x, the infinity norm is smaller than C2 times this other norm that we're looking at. Okay, this is what we are currently looking for. Again, this is something we yet have to prove. We haven't proved it yet. Okay, let's get started with this one. Now we define first of all a set that is convenient, namely the unit sphere according to the infinity norm. Let me write it down. So let S, which is the set X in RD, such that now the infinity norm of X equals 1, be the unit sphere with respect to the infinity norm. With respect to the infinity norm. So we just define. So observe, it's a set which exactly of points which have exactly norm equals 1. And now what I want to look at is I want to look at the norm, like I take all these points and want to look at the norm of these points under the other norm. So now I consider a mapping, consider a function f that goes from S to R. So it's, we just look at points on the unit sphere and we map x to the norm of x, now the other norm, not the infinity norm, the other one we're interested in. And now the first insight is the mapping f is continuous with respect to the infinity norm. Oh, sorry. And now I'm aware that we haven't really seen analysis so far in the lecture, but I hope that all of you know what a continuous map is. If not, we're going to see it in some of the lectures when we're in the analysis part. And the important thing here is we look at the continuity with respect to the infinity norm. Because like whenever you say a mapping is continuous, you always need to say in which norm you are or in which topology. What is it? What is the notion of points? Like continuity says essentially, if two points are close in the original space, then their images are also being close in the image space. And the measure by which you measure closeness is here. It's a norm in general. It could be a topology, and this is what defines what you need to define the continuity. So now we look into whether the thing is continuous with respect to the infinity norm. And why is this true? This follows directly from the following fact, from the fact that if you look, so you want to know, so if you want to look at continuity, you always need to check what is f of x minus f of y. And maybe let's simply write it down. And now, what is f of x is norm of x. And then we can write this as a norm of y. And now by the triangle inequality, we know that this is smaller than x minus y. And this, we have already seen that in the previous part, is smaller than c1 times x minus y infinity. So this function is even Lipschitz continuous. This is the definition of it. The Lipschitz constant is c1. So it is definitely continuous. Okay, so by now we know that this mapping is continuous. And now now we need to exploit a bit of topology on RD, and I'm also aware that I didn't explain all these backgrounds, and if you haven't seen that before, then maybe, I mean, I'm not going to ask this particular proof in an exam. Then try to look up the notions as far as you can, but I think most people would have seen that. The unit ball is closed and bounded in the sphere S is closed and bounded. Closed, I mean, this is something we could now prove, but I mean, bounded is obvious. Closed is also, if I have a sequence of points in the unit ball, then the limiting object is also going to sit in the unit ball. It is easy to prove, but formally you would need to do that. And we are now in a metric space, and if we know that we have a closed and bounded set in a metric space, it is already compact. So we call this, like in my lecture, it was called the theorem of Heine-Borel. I'm sure there are millions of names for that theorem, and we don't even need to have the name. So by the theorem, S is compact. And compact sets are sort of very nice topological sets. Now we know that if we have a continuous mapping, and it starts, and the space on which it is defined is compact, this continuous mapping attains its minimum and maximum. Let me write it down. So any continuous mapping on a compact set, takes its minimum and maximum. So what this means is, it couldn't be that the function values approximate, say, 5, but there is not a single point that takes 5 as the minimum or as the maximum, depending on what it is. And now we want to define, this is going to be the constant C2. We are going to define, so we define C2 is the minimum of, how do I write this? F of x, x in S. So this is now a definition, and this, and as we're going to see in a minute, this is the constant we are looking for. So what we now have is, if you compute the norm of x, I mean, just to see where we are heading, this is the same as x over 1. Now, we are on the unit sphere, so this is the same as the norm of x over the norm of x, the infinity norm, because S is the unit sphere with respect to the... No, sorry. Is it? Yes. Look back at the definition. I was just confused myself. Whenever you're confused, you need to make sure that what you're confused about is wrong. I was confused because I briefly thought that we had defined the set S in terms of the other norm, but looking back, is we defined the set S as being the set where the infinity norm is 1. This is good. So we know here, I mean the bottom line now, the infinity norm of X is 1 if we're on S. So maybe I should write here in the beginning, if x is in S, then we have the following computation. So the norm is 1. But now, by homogeneity, I can pull it out. I can say this is the same as x over norm infinity. Okay, so this is the inequality as far as we have it now. And now we know by the definition of C2, that the norm of x is always greater or equal than C2. So what we have is, if we now read it from left to right, we have that C2 is smaller or equal to norm x over x infinity. And from this I can, now we need to check in which direction do we need to prove the inequality. We want to have that x infinity is smaller or equal than C2 something. So now I bring x infinity to the other side, is smaller or equal to 1 over C2 times x. So maybe it would have been better to define, instead of C2, to define C2 tilde like this. And now we say, we define the constant C2 as being 1 over C2 tilde, and that, because then we have the nice statement as we would like to have it without a 1 over or something like that, we have x infinity is smaller than C2 times 1 over C2 times norm of x. And this is what we were supposed to prove.